Welcome to the Athenaeum. My name is Ned Scharf. Hi, Kathy. I was, until a month ago, president of the Athenaeum, which is only relevant tonight because I had a hand in recruiting our speaker, Beth Hessel. And I'll tell you the story. We had a very good recruiter in our employ. We had a number of very interesting candidates to be executive director of the Athenaeum. And then there was this oddball submission from a woman named Beth Hessel. And I looked at it and I saw that she was an ordained minister. And I thought, that's great, but what do we need that for? Also a PhD in history. I kind of felt like we'd had enough academics in our history, and maybe we needed a more of a, you know, a doer and a shaker. But then we met her, and as for those of you who don't know Beth, you will see that she is sensational, sensationally interesting, sensationally capable, imaginative, and I think that was that recruitment process was, I think, almost 5 years ago, wasn't it? Beth is coming up on her fifth anniversary here. And I don't think I'm overstating things to say that she has made things sing here in a way that has begun to utterly transform this institution in ways that the fact that you're here means that you agree with me. In ways that are most agreeable and so additive to our community. So she is a multi-talented person, an intellectual, a great administrator, a person who is a real magnet for the neighborhood. And I can't think what else to tell you about her, except here's Beth.
Thank you, Ned. I kind of put him on the spot when he came in because I'm always the host, and I realized I'd be introducing myself and asked him if he would, but if I'd known he would say all that, I would have grabbed someone else in the room to do it. But thank you, Ned, for embarrassing me very much. And I nodded when you said 5 years, and I think it's because the pandemic added at least another year to everybody's math now, but it's actually coming up on I'll finish my 4 years in July and then be starting my fifth year. But I think as we've been done so much and been through so much that it feels like much longer. It's an honor to be here. It's weird to be here as the speaker and not just as the host, but I've been giving talking about the Athenaeum to institutions all over the city for the last 2 years. And as we are marking the 175th anniversary of this building of the Athenaeums now, and with our exhibit downstairs, you can learn more about the building and the history of the building and what was going on in Philadelphia and our nation in that period of time. And I hope you'll take time, if you haven't seen that exhibit, to do so. I thought, what better way to kind of put this talk or some version of it to bed after 2 years so I can move on to some other kind of talk than to do it at the Athenaeum. And I'll tell you, this morning we came in, Christina said, I need to set up the room, and asked Valerie, how many people have registered? And she said, 27. I said, oh no. So thank you all for coming. We had about 80, 90 people to hear Witold Rybczynski last week, and so I thought, oh gosh, okay, I know where I stand. So thank you all for coming very much. But hopefully this will be an interesting talk, and we'll have time for questions afterwards and conversation, and I'm just glad you're here. So the 175th anniversary of our National Historic Building, which is just part of our 208-year history as an institution, seems to be one of those times for those of us who love books and access to knowledge, those of us who prize Philadelphia's unique array of historic and newer emerging arts and culture organizations to reflect on the history of membership-supported libraries and their value in today's ecosystem. The question we might want to ask is, how does a library like ours contribute to the well-being of our neighborhoods and our country? And this is a question that Ned and Jeffrey Cooper, who's our new president, and I see Jeff Cohen down here, new to our board, and others who have been on the board and in the leadership have been asking over the past 4 years. What does a library and how does a library like ours contribute to the well-being of our neighborhoods and our country? Well, during World War II, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt kind of pointed to what he saw as the answer to that. He said, "Libraries are directly and immediately involved in the conflict which divides the world, and for two reasons." Remember, this is World War II. First, because they are essential to the functioning of a democratic society. Second, because the contemporary conflict touches the integrity of scholarship, the freedom of the mind, and even the survival of culture. And libraries are the great symbols of the freedom of the mind. Libraries are the great symbols of the freedom of the mind. Whether we source books or librettos or lend out gardening tools or crafting tools, whether we offer children's programming, language workshops, music performances, or book clubs, whether we have special collections open for research and scholarship, or librarians who are gifted at finding you the perfect next book to read that will challenge and inspire you, libraries are places for people to gather around ideas and dreams and histories and hopes for the future. Access to knowledge and to ideas, to the hope found in books and learning, to the stories and those people and institutions and objects that do the work of storytelling, of building community, of pointing to ways to healthily and peacefully resolve conflict and derive solutions to the thorniest problems that haunt our cultures are a basis of freedom and democracy. And all of those, I would argue, and I hope you would agree, are found in libraries. We rightly hail the advent of the printing press as one of the greatest inventions ever. I don't know, I would say it's about one of the greatest, penicillin and the printing press. The Protestant Reformation, if you remember, relied on the printing press, as did the American Revolution, and countless other movements for greater diversity and inclusion and independence. By the early 18th century, the printing press enabled the flourishing of books beyond what had just been spiritual or religious books towards scholarly and literary books that were more widely available. Printers and publishers in Europe adjoined their subscription libraries to their businesses, encouraging the rapid and steady circulation of books among those with spare funds to borrow and wear out extra copies of books that publishers had printed. In Philadelphia, Benjamin Franklin and his junto started the library company in 1731, the first subscription library in the colonies in North America. Subscribers pooled their funds to support a book buyer who bought the books that they requested over in Europe because they still weren't available or printed here in the United States. The Crown would not allow that. And then those books could be checked out by members. And checked out. The library company did not have a reading room, so you would go and check out the book and take it home. This first public library, meaning a library that was not privately held by an individual or a college or a church, but was available to anyone who could afford a membership, spawned several generations of subscription libraries, of about 16 of which about are still in existence around the United States. By the time of the American Revolution, there were subscription libraries serving varieties of populations and reading interests around the colonies. There were ones for business people, there were ones for lawyers, there were ones for families, for women that specialized in fiction, all sorts of different libraries. Many of them would run out of an entrepreneur's front room, where for a fee, individuals could access reading material for edification or for amusement. There are stories of individuals who might borrow, say, one of Shakespeare's plays in the morning, return it in the afternoon, and pick out another book to read overnight in order to make the most of their subscription. Most of these libraries, however, did not survive the British occupation, which left room for new forms of culture building in the young nation. I'm going to jump ahead a couple of years. After the War of 1812, the city was still sort of trying to figure out who we were, but after the War of 1812, the Republican Party, not today's Republican Party, then Republican Party, controlled Pennsylvania's political life. Out-of-power Federalists, not Democrats, remember, Federalists and Republicans, will take us back to, what, it was an eighth grade U.S. history class to remember all of our civics. Out-of-power Federalists did what minority parties often do. Lacking enough votes to shift the political system, they turned their focus on civic culture in the city. Historian Albrecht Kolschnick has argued that lawyers, doctors, merchants, among a robust group of young Federalists like Robert Fox, Thomas Isaac Wharton, Robert Hobart Smith, Alexander Sidney Cox, and John Cole Lauber, some of those names may ring bells to you, and it's either them or some of their relatives. They were themselves already third and fourth generation Philadelphians related to other Philadelphians who had made their mark in the city. These young men envisioned themselves, he says, as civic leaders. They constructed civic culture, usually together with older men like Chief Justice William Tilghman, Dr. James Meese, and Nicholas Biddle, in the form of societies that supported the arts, the legal profession, and the preservation and celebration of Pennsylvania history. In this new generation of organizations, Kolschnick continues, they continued their assertion of cultural authority and stewardship, occasionally inviting conservative Republicans to join them in these ventures. So culture making as a form of forming a culture at large, when you can't form it at the ballot box. They turned their attention to culture building in Philadelphia, which at the turn of the 19th century was the largest city in the United States. Now, Boston may have held the prize for the deepest pockets among its philanthropists. They say those Puritans were a lot more generous with their money than the Quakers. I've heard that joke a lot, actually, since moving to Philadelphia. But Philadelphia led in the creation of cultural institutions. By 1825, it boasted more than any other major city and was rightly called the Athens of America. In 1811, the above-mentioned Dr. James Meese, who is perhaps best remembered for his invention of tomato-based ketchup. I love that about him, tomato-based ketchup. He published a book with a never-ending title. The Picture of Philadelphia was a 372-page book. Remember, publishing was not cheap, 372 pages with illustrations and lots of writing. The Picture of Philadelphia, giving an account of its origin, increase, and improvements in arts, sciences, manufactures, commerce, and revenue. The title went on. In this book, Meese described the city in meticulous detail, as in, the city is lighted by 1,132 lamps enclosed in glass lanterns, most of them lighted only on those nights when the moon does not give sufficient light. I mean, would you want to be the guy who had to go light all of those lights every night? The improved parts are paved with round stones brought from the bed of the Delaware at Trenton Falls, and the degree of the uniformity of the brick houses has always appeared a striking defect to intelligent strangers. As to the Institute, and I remember when Alexis de Tocqueville visited, he was just appalled at the uniformity of the buildings. I got lost trying to find my place. He said, I heard of somebody who left his bride-to-be at a friend's house and went off to do some errands and then couldn't find his way back and forgot to find out the address. So I don't know whether, he says, I don't know if he ever found his bride and got to marry her. As to the institutions of which the Athenaeum would soon become a part, Meese noted that Philadelphia had 3 libraries, 4 banks, 6 schools, 8 daily papers, 11 insurance companies, 13 charitable institutions, 43 places of worship, 51 printers, 102 hatters, and 3,648 spinning wheels. Soon added to these institutions were others started by many of the same men who founded the Athenaeum. PAFA, which was the nation's first art school and permanent art museum, started in 1805. They started the Academy of Natural Sciences in 1812. The Franklin Institute and the Historical Society of Pennsylvania, they started in 1824. And of course, the Athenaeum of Philadelphia in 1814, kind of in the middle of all that. These same men also spurred prison reform, public schools, hospitals, and many charitable institutions to address issues like underemployment, homelessness, poverty, and the needs of immigrants, women, and children. Now, I find it instructive, and maybe you find it interesting too, that the founders of the Athenaeum and so many of our institutions were young. More than half of the first shareholders of the Athenaeum were under the age of 30. Many of those founders were 23, 24 years old, having just served in the War of 1812. After having graduated from UPenn or the Pennsylvania University and getting their law degrees, studying under some of these other lawyers, and then fighting the War of 1812 and coming back and say, you know what, we can't get in office, let's start some institutions. So for as much as those of us, many of us here, who have earned a half century or more of wisdom value what we gain from those years of experience, it is often the youth who instigate revolutions and reformations in our lives. Think again of the Protestant Reformation. Luther and Calvin were actually very young men in the Reformation. Elizabeth I, when she became queen and sort of revolutionized England, young woman. Martin Luther King and all of the civil rights marchers, so many young people. Steve Jobs, Mark Zuckerberg. And perhaps we might not be surprised that we owe so much of the historical richness and resonance of our city to the young. Perhaps their desire to make their mark and create a space for their own flourishing outside of the confines of the society that had been shaped by their elders led them to innovate, and innovate they did. On Monday, March 7th, 1814, if you had opened up Polson's American Daily Advertiser, one of those 54-some papers that were available in Philadelphia, you would have noticed that there was the opening of a new library. The Athenaeum of Philadelphia on the second story of A. Finley's bookstore on the southeast corner of Chestnut and 4th Street. The primary purpose of the Athenaeum was to provide a reading room stocked with, quote, newspapers and periodical publications of Philadelphia and those of merit from the other states, together with pamphlets of a useful and amusing nature, maps, charts, etc., as well as a chess room, a conversation room, and expanded hours not offered anywhere else. The advertisement noted that the Athenaeum's founders hoped that the new subscription library would host, quote, popular lectures upon chemistry, natural philosophy, and a museum to contain specimens of the animal, vegetable, and mineral kingdoms, scientifically arranged, natural and artificial curiosities, coins, metals, gems, intaglios, etc. When you think about useful knowledge then, it was knowledge of the natural world as well as the inventions and innovations that were just turning the world into a whole new place in the turn of the 19th century. One of the founders, a young lawyer named Robert Hobart Smith, later said that the hopes of his fellow founders were to make the Athenaeum a place for the pursuit of excellence, honor, and usefulness. Or as another put it, a convenient place of common resort in which their leisure hours could be passed without danger to morals or tastes. The handful of Athenaeum founders considered themselves a band of young men whose age, habits, pursuits, and prospects are nearly the same. Most, they say, have been born in the same city, acquainted from early childhood, educated often in the same schools. Isn't this what we tell our kids when they go looking for jobs? It's who you know that helps you get a job. Played out here. Most of them had law offices or shops in the bustling vicinity of the courthouse, which was nearby, and desired a place where, according to another founder, Thomas Isaac Wharton, they could, quote, withdraw themselves for however short a period from the absorbing occupations of the counting house and the forum, for the purpose of engaging in pursuits of a merely abstract and intellectual character, which pay no pecuniary interest and yield no tangible dividend, to invest some of their capital in stocks which are never heard of at the broker's board, and to turn aside occasionally from the bustle and the strife, the fever and the competition of this busy and sordid world of ours for the pure waters and quiet retreats of the letters and the arts. Now that's a symbol of freedom of the mind, is it not? And the Athenaeum quickly outgrew its rooms at Chestnut Street. Within a few years, the Athenaeum would lodge on the first floor of the Philosophical Society. Its membership grew in those early years to more than 350 members. Some were shareholders who bought a share and then paid annual dues of $5, and others were $3, and others were subscribers who paid annual dues of $5. The Athenaeum's record of stranger also has a tally of the distinguished and ordinary out-of-town guests who made use of the reading rooms while in Philadelphia. Signed in by a member, visitors like Eliza Hamilton, who was one of the first known female visitor to the Athenaeum in this very building in 1847 when she was in her 90s. Alexis de Tocqueville and Gustave Beaumont when they were here in the United States studying prison reform. Charles Dickens and countless other statesmen, businessmen, authors, and reformers. They found in the Athenaeum room for meaningful conversation about major issues of the day. The Athenaeum, as I said, boasted a newspaper room, a chess room, and a conversation room, the only place in the city with all three of these spots in one place. While it was not a circulating library until the 1850s, its collections remained true to the original aim of the library to provide access to useful knowledge with a focus on newspapers from Philadelphia, but also around the country and internationally. Maps and maritime charts, encyclopedias, dictionaries, a collection of 15,000 volumes of periodicals from around the world, subscriptions to more than 50 newspapers and 36 literary and scientific journals. It was a place where people could come and learn. It had a limited supply of novels. If you look downstairs in our exhibit, you'll see some of those novels that we had in the 19th century that come from our original collection. Its policies actually literally tolerated but discouraged the reading of novels. At that time, they were considered sort of frippery, not good morally. To give you an idea of what was in our original collection, it boasted the 1593 edition of the Latin Bible, the 9-volume American Ornithology, Moore's Mathematics, Gibbon's History of Rome, Jefferson's Notes on Virginia, and Humboldt's Travels. Just a sense of the wide variety of fields which were considered useful knowledge for a young man or a professional man in the early Republic. The Athenaeum aimed from the start to be a place of useful and agreeable resort for members and the public, with reading hours from 7 a.m. to 10 p.m. 6 days per week, and please don't ask us to do that here. I don't know if my kids would ever speak to me again. The generous hours encouraged a wide range of professional men to join the Athenaeum. The congeniality of the Athenaeum was in fact well known from its beginnings. While New York City boasted several acclaimed subscription libraries in the early 19th century, including the New York Society Library, founded in 1754 and still in existence, the General Society Library of New York City, and the Mercantile Library, which is now the Center for Fiction in Brooklyn, which were both founded in 1820, these libraries are still here. As an Athenaeum member, let me know and I can get you a red carpet rolled out and you can go visit them. They had all of these, but one visitor from New York City in 1824 said, "New York has no institution to compare with the Athenaeum. A comparison of the libraries of the two cities, and especially the situation of each as to pecuniary matters, would place New York far behind her rival in matters of correct taste and liberality." Score one for Philadelphia, right? As Kolchnik quotes from the Athenaeum's minutes, the directors of the Athenaeum envisioned it becoming a, quote, "abundant source of refined and elegant entertainment, of rational occupation, of permanent usefulness, containing a rich mine for general research and a various and inexhaustible fund of knowledge from which the stockholder may, at his own option, derive an intellectual dividend of any magnitude." Presaging Roosevelt's comments, the Athenaeum's leadership saw their little library as a symbol of the freedom of the mind, the basis for a culture of democracy. By 1847, the Athenaeum had once again outgrown its space, and it acquired funds to build its own lodgings. The directors desired a building of chaste and simple architecture, conveniently situated and of ample dimensions. Those language, you could almost think of Greco and Roman ideals, simple and chaste architecture, but they didn't go with Greco or Roman architecture, which was what most of the city looked like at that time. The winning design in the architectural competition actually came from John Notman, who was already known for his design of Laurel Hill Cemetery and the Academy of Natural Sciences. Notman gave us this National Historic Landmark building, one of the first public brownstone buildings in the city and the earliest example of the Italian Revival style, a building that stood out for its simple and stately style when it was built. In order to cover the costs of maintaining the new edifice, the Athenaeum rented out its unfinished third floor and its first floor as offices for lawyers and merchants and organizations like the Philadelphia School District, the American Institute of Architects, and the Historical Society of Pennsylvania. In the 20th century, the Athenaeum was home to the Victorian Society and the Independent Seaport Museum. The lavish second floor reading room was reserved for members. That one over there, looking now like it did then, almost exactly. More comfortable seating for 21st century bodies. And the journal room also was here. This room here, right behind you, would have been the floor to ceiling shelves which held, cases which held the journals and newspapers to which the Athenaeum subscribed and for which it was best known. At the dedication of our current building in 1847, then President Thomas Isaac Wharton ended his speech by musing on the rare presence of women at the dedication. Let us indulge the hope, he ended his speech, that the time is not far distant when this exclusiveness on the part of man will give way to a more just sense of his relative importance and dignity in the scale of society and the arrangements of providence, and that he will at last be convinced that there are other places besides ballrooms and theaters in which the sexes can meet on terms of equality. That was 1847. In 1857, more than 50 years after the Athenaeum was established, the library welcomed its first woman shareholder, Elizabeth Kuhn, who received her father's share upon his death. For the rest of the 19th century, women slowly trickled into membership in twos and threes, growing in the 20th century so that now we are pretty equally divided between men and women, which I think makes for a much richer, I may be biased, but I think it makes for a much richer library. Wharton also, in his speech, expressed his hope on the opening of the Athenaeum that the, quote, time would come when the whole or the greater portion of this building must be devoted to the purposes for which it was established. He opined, we must have a lecture room and gratuitous lectures, apartments for the reception and display of useful instruments and inventions, medals, coins, and other curiosities, rooms for conversation and various other valuable purposes. The institution will then bear a nearer resemblance to those establishments of Greece and Rome from which it derives its name. I love that quote. I came upon it, and Ned, I hadn't seen it before, but I mean, this is exactly where we have been trying to bring the Athenaeum in line with what the original members hoped we would become. It's kind of exciting. By the late 19th century, the Athenaeum was part of a national network of subscription libraries that grew out of a desire to address educational and cultural needs of growing metropolises. In emerging cities like Cincinnati and St. Louis and San Francisco, as well as in Philadelphia, mechanics institutes were started, which aimed to provide training and technical education to the trades in support of commerce. As we can see, as industry increased in the young nation, so did the desire to provide access to informal education for the growing workforce and civilization, I put that in quotes, to the growing masses of immigrants. Even as the public library system grew under Andrew Carnegie, subscription libraries remained relevant incubators of art, education, and literature freedom of the mind. For example, the Mechanics Institute of San Francisco opened its doors in 1854 to provide adult technical education and retraining for the factories and shipyards that the city hoped would restore its economy after the collapse of the gold rush. Just as the Athenaeum had a chess room on its premises, the San Francisco Mechanics Library or Institute started a chess club that today is the oldest continuously running chess club in the city. Subscriptions libraries like the Athenaeum were often the first publicly available collections of books and were innovators in cataloging and collecting. The Boston Athenaeum, for example, started art collections that led to the Boston Museum of Art. While the Charleston Library Society, also started in the 18th century, was a home for the authors and artists like Dubose Hayward, Edward Hopper, and Hervey Allen, who led the Charleston Renaissance in the early 20th century. Meanwhile, the La Jolla, California Athenaeum became a repository of important printed and manuscript music scores. Yet over time, many membership libraries closed or merged with other libraries. The Mercantile Library in Philadelphia, which opened in 1821 to serve middle-class families, was once bigger in membership and collections than the Athenaeum and kept asking us to merge with them because they wanted our periodicals collection. But it merged with the Philadelphia Free Library in 1989, making us the last standing, still circulating membership library in Philadelphia. For years, these subscription libraries struggled to find their places in post-industrial cities. The Athenaeum of Philadelphia's own membership lagged by the late 19th century and then struggled along, saw a little resurgence, and then by the late 20th century was again struggling as the center of the city's legal and commercial businesses moved westwards and professionals retreated to the suburbs. Yet the Athenaeum and its dozen or so surviving siblings have survived and thrived, finding new footing as the cities in which they exist change, and they change with it. Just as the e-book has complemented rather than supplanted physical books, our subscription libraries continue to complement rather than be supplanted by the many other sources that people have for accessing books and community and knowledge. In an age when so much is franchised and prepackaged and sold to us as drive-through, instant, whatever, membership libraries like the Athenaeum offer something different, unique, and a bit rare. We provide living, breathing sanctuaries that echo in our architecture and spaces the spaciousness of time, the possibility of encountering something precious and original, the awe of beauty. I'm hearing a lot lately about how the Athenaeum is one of those prized third spaces, a term we probably hadn't heard of pre-pandemic. It's not a home, it's not an office, but it is a third space where individuals can come to think and work or recharge and to expand their vision. Stepping into one of our membership libraries is to encounter spaces designed for reading and thinking with ample natural light and lots of wood and plenty of books and art to delight the senses. We are the antithesis, I would say, to most college libraries that are proudly proclaiming that they're getting rid of the book. We have the books and we also have the space for the conversation. Most of our membership libraries also contain special collections that invite researchers and the general public to engage in appreciation of the past. At the Athenaeum, we boast a world-recognized architectural archives that allow the curious and the academic-minded to better understand Philadelphia's rich contributions to the built environment of our nation and our world, and the ways that our buildings and our landscapes have shaped and been shaped by the diverse communities that inhabit our city. We have also reclaimed that original aim to host popular lectures upon a range of relevant topics. The Athenaeum entices members and the broader community with renowned authors and thinkers from Philadelphia and beyond who help shape us into a community of dialogue on history and architecture, preservation and literature and the sciences. at receptions or small book club meetings or over the recent books table or latest exhibitions, members and neighbors find themselves learning more about one another and our world as they reflect upon the most recent author talk or book they read or inspiring exhibition or travels they plan on taking. While people may check out books and attend lectures at the free library, it is the Athenaeum where they find librarians who know their name and remember their reading preferences. A neighborhood institution that encourages the creation of community and connection on an intimate scale. Because the mission of membership libraries is tighter and more limited than public libraries, we can add value to what the public library offers. We can provide the best in historic collections and carefully curated circulating books. We can offer speaking locations for less well-known writers and thinkers and creators whose voices need to be heard. We can provide quiet spaces designed for creative work and reading and conversation with a staff who is dedicated to the pursuit of knowledge and relationship. We hear this from our members and community who reflect in the words of one of them, through a stimulating agenda of exhibitions and speakers, both online and in person, the Athenaeum has proven to be a wonderful intellectual lifeline during the late unpleasantness of the pandemic and beyond. And of another, when you step into the Athenaeum, you're not only stepping into history, you're adding to it. Everyone who walks through these doors leaves their own mark there and takes some of it home with them. Fun to think about. What do you take home with you and what do you leave here when you come to the Athenaeum? Today's Athenaeum of Philadelphia, like our other surviving membership libraries, is a library with a complex legacy and a vibrant future. Our smallness enables us to nimbly partner with sister institutions around the country and here in Philadelphia to provide programming and initiatives that enrich members and the larger community. We can model new ideas and ways of engaging with one another and books and ideas with culture creation, even as our city and nation grapple with major concerns like gun violence and homelessness, the drug addiction crisis, a pandemic which has shaped a generation of youth who are now in crisis, and a faction of our country that wishes to limit access to books and ideas and conversations that they find threatening. As a member-supported institution, we follow in our founder's footsteps so that young people, as they say, and old, might pass their hours of leisure in the acquirement of valuable knowledge within the walls of this useful institution. Thank you. So I left plenty of time for questions, if there are any. Questions, comments, thoughts?
How much of the original collection?
You know, thank you for reminding me, Sandra. So how many of that items of that original collection survive? I don't think we know exactly, but not many. There was actually a point, and I think it was in the late 19th or early 20th century, we had some of Ben Franklin's books and found that we could not take care of them properly. There were pages missing from some, for example, they'd been torn out. And so we gave them to the Historical Society of Pennsylvania. So there have been times when those collections have been given elsewhere because the Athenaeum was not providing proper stewardship of them. As a circulating library, the goal was never to hold on to everything either. You'll find that any circulating library doesn't necessarily view itself as a special collection as it's creating itself. And so it may afterwards say, oh wait, if we'd known we were going to be around for 200 years, we would have kept all those original books. So a lot were not kept. Many of our other, like the Boston Athenaeum, or the New York Society Library have amazing collections that are their original collections that they held on to, which, you know, we can wish now that we had, but we did not. But that's a great question.
At the time of founding, Philadelphia was still basically
Yeah, so Robert Fox, who is one of our founders, and we could say, you know, he gets credit for so many of these institutions. He was a real leader. He was a Quaker. His younger sister, older sister, died at a young age, and it really shaped him. She had been like a mother to him. And so he vowed that he'd spend a few years working, but after that, devote his life to philanthropy. And he did, and he helped start most of these institutions that we mentioned. So he was a Quaker. At its start, though, the Athenaeum, there were at least 8 or 9 different denominations, Christian and Jewish, represented in the founding of the Athenaeum. So it was intentionally always a secular, non-denominational organization. And if you'd looked at their journals, they would have had, you know, the Methodist Journal and the Presbyterian Journal and the, you know, the Quaker, you know, all, everybody was really represented in the founding. Gosh, does someone else here know? The literacy rate in the mid-19th century, does anybody know? You've stumped me. Does anybody know that answer? Can anybody Google it really quickly? I think the nation always had a higher literacy rate than in Europe from the beginning, because there was always sort of this focus on some sort of education and learning for people and basic reading. So I think it was probably a fairly high literacy rate. I think it would have seen as we got to the latter half of the 19th century, as we started getting a huge influx of immigrants coming in from Eastern Europe and Western Europe, that literacy rate would have dropped because of the number of immigrants in the population who were coming from countries where they had not had education and not had the opportunity to learn to read. And then, you know, all those little kids were sent to work in factories, which was why there were things like apprentices' libraries that were started. And Andrew Carnegie came over at the age of 12. His father was a weaver in Scotland. And they came over here, they were impoverished and came over here. He started working out as a bobbin boy. But after a year, he was lucky enough to get a job as a telegraph messenger boy and did so well that he was quickly kept being promoted. But as a telegraph messenger boy, he became connected with a philanthropist who had a 400-volume library, which he opened in the evenings to young working boys for them to get education. And that led to his saying, you know, when he made his millions, I don't need more than $50,000 a year. I don't know what that would have been in like 1890, whatever, matters. I don't need $50,000 a year to live off of. From there, I'm going to, you know, give it all away. And he spent $30 million starting libraries, Carnegie libraries around the country. There were 25, 28 of them that were started in Philadelphia, that were Carnegie libraries. He agreed to put up the money to build the edifices and to fill them, but the local governments had to agree to provide the equal amount of money for the land and for the maintenance and staffing of the libraries. So it was really, yes, you've got an answer. Amazing. So the literacy rate was probably higher than it is in the United States today at that period in time. Yeah, that's great. Yes?
Can you say anything about the relationship between the Athenaeum and the library company? Was there overlapping membership? I would imagine there were people who joined a lot of like me, but you said,
yeah. So I don't know if they talked to each other very much, but there was definitely an overlap in the membership. They were basically different kinds of libraries, though. When we started, the library company was circulating, but they had no reading room. So you could go and check out a book, but you had to take it home. They also, they had, in like, it was 1796, at some point in time, they had combined with another library that had, that allowed women to be members, so then they had female members as well, so it was men and women. Their hours were much shorter. They closed, they opened like around 2 or something and closed at sunset, and were open 5 days a week. So limited hours, men and women could be members, and there was no reading room. So the young men who started here, they did not want women to be members. I mean, most of them were young single guys, and they wanted to come here and be able to hang out in the evenings and talk about girls. You know, seriously. They wanted to just feel free, and so they didn't want to feel like they had to behave in proper society and the mores of the time. So the longer hours, extended hours, we were not circulating until 1855. John Livesey left a bequest for the purchasing of more volumes, and at that point, and if you open, check out a book from the Athenaeum, open it up, and you may see a book plate, and you may find a book plate. This is the John Livesey Fund. So that would be a book that was bought from this endowment that continues to support the purchasing of books at the Athenaeum. So the books were not circulating. Our hours were much longer. People had a place to come and hang out and spend time together. We also focused, the library company was focused on books, but we also, you saw, we had this expansive dream of lectures, which didn't come to place because we didn't happen because we didn't have space for it, but also of collecting, having a little museum, a natural history sort of museum and a Pennsylvania history museum. So it was a much different kind of library. So it'd be like being a member here today and the library company and the Academy of Natural Sciences. We're all different beasts, even though we kind of travel in a similar world. So you're asking about how we compare as much of our collection has been digitized as compared to other institutions in the area? Okay. So digitization is an interesting, you know, before this I was at the Presbyterian Historical Society, which its size of its collection is this collection here is very tiny compared to everything we had there. And people would say, well, why don't you just digitize everything and then throw away the originals? Now, if you're an archivist or a social collections librarian, you know the standard for a manuscript or object or document is its original form. If it was created digital, an email, then it's you know, that's the form that you want to keep it in, is that digital form. If it was created on paper, you want to keep it on paper. Paper is also a lot more stable than digital. Just think every time your iPhone changes, or how many computers have you been through, and you know, different forms, and they don't talk to one another. We don't use floppy disks anymore. We don't use cassettes anymore. So it keeps changing. So there's that question of maintaining the stability. And then there's the question of access. Not only does digitization require a lot of resources, a lot of time, most special collections, they would count in the number of decades it would take to digitize everything in their collection if they had, say, 20 people working around the clock nonstop. But also the interest. Not everything that every institution has is of enough interest to be digitized. So you might as well just keep it in paper format or the original format, since not everybody will want to see whatever that was. Like, okay, Presbyterian Historical Society, how many people are going to want to read the church records of that little church in Canton, Ohio? Members of that church might want to, but they might even fall asleep reading it. So the effort required means that you might not want to, and the cost of storage. And then the concern that every couple of years you're changing technology, and then you have to make sure you're able to transfer what you have into a new technology. So the Athenaeum, we did get a lot digitized as part of the both the Philadelphia Architects and Builders grant that we received, which includes other institutions, about 20 years ago, and was about, Jeff, was about 12 years ago that we did GeoHistory Network. But somewhere around that. So in the last 20 years, we have digitized a bunch of things which are now on our website, whether the GeoHistory Network or the Philadelphia Architects and Builders, which makes a lot of things available. But there's still a lot that's not, in part because our collection continues to grow. I hope that answered a little bit. Yeah. So when did the Athenaeum focus on architecture? So Bruce Laverty, our curator, is the perfect person to ask this question because he can tell you, and he'll tell you exactly everything that we have in our collection too. He's got this amazing mind to be able to remember all of this. But it was in the 1980s. We received the bequest from Henry Magaziner's family for his collection, which meant we went from however many, you know, a couple hundred pieces that we had that were the Athenaeums to tens of thousands of items. And then we got Paul Cray, and we started building, and it's sort of like, okay, we have a little movement here, and Roger Moss, who was then the executive director, had been searching for something that we might make as our special collection, something that we might collect to give us a name, like the Library Company or the Philosophical Society, and so this created the movement. And once, you know, once people start hearing, oh, you've got Henry Magaziner, you have Paul Cray, well, maybe we can put our papers there. So that helped lead to the focus on architectural collections. It's a great question. Yes, so when did we go lighting and when? So originally gas, and of course our original hours, we were above Mr. Finley's bookstore. So I don't know what the lighting was there. If anybody knows the answer, just raise your hand. We did, it was in the 19th century, I think, that we moved here. I mean, we started here with gas and we went to electric, seems like by the end of the 19th century, but don't quote me, please. And anybody watching this later on, on the video, don't quote me, please. We can get the right answer from Bruce again. Bruce will know what year we went to electricity. But yeah, all of these were piped originally for gas. He was there. Bruce was there, probably. At least in spirit, he was there. Okay, so in England and Wales, men was 50%, women was 30%. So the colonies in the early United States, really, the emphasis on learning was really important. On education has always been a hallmark of this country. Yeah. Any other questions? So what is the third floor used for now? So in the 90s, we said goodbye to our final tenants, and the Athenaeum became the Athenaeum fully, all floors. It was mostly used for storage up there for our books. And then our structural engineers walked through and said, hey, this building is not designed the way it's designed. It's not designed to hold this much weight. Most of that either was cold and weeded out, as good librarians do, or sent off to offsite storage, so you don't have to worry about the roof coming down on you. One section of it became staff offices, and part of these recent renovations we did was taking that space from the 19th century up to the 20th century. I say 20th because there's no bathrooms up there yet. But we gave the staff up there running water, a little kitchenette, and we gave them heat. So I think you should be happy. to know that. It's a little shocking to say that. We had AC up there already, but it was a pretty dreary, awful place to work. We put film on the windows also, so now the shades can be lifted up and light comes in. And it's really a lovely space now. And we uncovered a furnace molding around the door frame, which had sort of been hidden and lost in all of that. So that was really neat, because that had been the office space for the AIA, Philadelphia chapter of the American Institute of Architects. So they had that furnace door frame, which was really lovely. Bonnie. Thank you, Bonnie. I didn't plant her to say that. But I think that's big kudos for our staff and the hard work they do, and the love that they have, not just for our resources that we have here, but for all of you. And if you're not a member, talk to Bonnie and she'll convince you to become a member. Thank you. Yes. So this is another question I did not plant. What projects are we working on, and what kind of funding might we be hoping for, if there are any deep pockets in the room? So right now, the last 4 years of the pandemic, as we all know, has been a time when we have all had to be incredibly flexible and constantly recalibrating our lives. And the Athenaeum has been the same. Every time we think, okay, this is how it's going to be, something changes and we have to change. So Tess in the back and I take a lead on programming, for example, and we've been watching the changes in how people respond to programming. Programming that pre-pandemic would have brought 60 to 90 people now might bring 20 or 30 people. In part because there's so many other places that now do programming, and great programming too. And also people's lives are busier. So one of the things we've noticed that people love is our Member Mondays, and coming and getting to engage with one another and learn. I mean, I have people saying, oh, please keep these up, because we have so many interesting members and we're loving to get to know them all. We are thinking of creating more intimate opportunities to gather, salons, where we can have smaller gatherings intended to be able to learn from members who are writers or volunteers at places or have vocations or businesses or work that are pushing boundaries and maybe of interest, whether it's, making spirits in the 19th century style, or working with NASA, or whatever it is that someone's doing, and have opportunities to gather together. And creating a few signature events where we might bring some higher profile authors and writers to talk not just about the current book that they're trying to sell, but their oeuvre and their life's work, for those deeper conversations. Since we know the free library is great at bringing in all the people who are selling the books on the path. So how can we bring someone in like Barbara Kingsolver? Now she's run a Pulitzer. I hope she would consider coming here. And we're just continue to think about how we continue to build the library to really serve the growing neighborhood around here, from children to adults of all ages, and whatever we need to do to best serve you, our members. Thank you. Thank you all.